Yvan Keller, the pillow killer, is the most prolific French serial killer of the 20th century. While he is implicated in only 23 murders, I mean, only 23. That's not a lot or anything, dirtbag. He is believed to have committed 40 murders and confesses to murdering 150 between 1989 and 2006 across France, Switzerland, and Germany. Let's dig into this gas bag story, but first, a quick look at the killers I've covered so far. Hi there. My name is Misha, and my channel is called All Things True Crime. If you enjoy this video, please take a quick second to like it and subscribe to my channel so you won't miss any new content. That's All Things True Crime. Okay, so Yvan Keller, his story begins on December 13, 1960, in Wittenheim, Holland. Did you just cuss at me, Misha? I didn't, I promise. In France, northeastern France, specifically, in the Grand Est region. It borders Germany, Belgium, and Luxembourg in Switzerland. So a region is similar to a state here in the United States. Inside the state or region of Grand Est is a department called Haran, I think. I probably butchered that name. Departments are similar to counties. Inside this Haran is a commune or city called Wittenheim. This is where Yvan is born. When he is born, the population is around 10,000 and is known for mining, as it has two mining villages. Yvan's parents are basket makers and sedentary travelers. Now, what in the heck is a sedentary traveler? I guess it's someone who doesn't like to do much when traveling, or maybe moves often. I don't know. Kind of a weird fact about his parents. He is one of nine children. His father works in the potash mines. The family is quite unstable in many ways. And due to this instability, he is required to work from a young age to help support the family. No surprise. Nine kids, 11 mouths to feed, bodies to clothe. That's expensive no matter how you cut it. So his father is an abusive, brutal man who often beats his kids with his belt, specifically in the evenings. One of Yvan's brothers later refers to it as, quote, belt blows often served as dessert. Yikes. So his mom dies at a young age, 49. One of the children says that she dies exhausted by what he calls ambient violence. You know, I mean, that's severe psychological abuse. I mean, all psychological abuse is severe, I guess, right? But this is gaslighting. Super messed up stuff. Kind of like, you know, after you abuse the person, the abuser's like, well, you know, this is for the best. Or, you know, I only do it because I love you. Messed up. What a dirtbag. Stand-up dude. Not. So Yvan is forced to miss school regularly at first to work to provide for his family. But then it transforms into stealing for his father. One of his brothers is ordered to steal copper wire wherever he can find it. Copper can sell for a lot, right? That's still true today. So he ends up attempting to steal high voltage copper one time, electrical cables, and he fries his hands something terrible, sustaining permanent injuries and damage. All for dad. It's messed up. So by 1981, or in 1981, at the age of 21, Kellon stops Yvan. He helps rob a series of antique dealers in Wittenheim. He is caught, don't know how, but he's eventually caught, and the police find many other antiques at his residence. I guess he hadn't sold them all yet. So he apparently has a fondness for art and antiques and keeps them because he likes them. Bad robber. The idea is to sell things that you steal. So anyway, he is sentenced to 10 years in prison for armed robbery, and violent robbery, as they call it, probably just because he had a weapon. He's released in 1989. That's less than 10 years, I would assume, due to good behavior. It's in August of the same year that he begins what ends up becoming a 17-year killing spree. He is released in Alzac and stays there. There, he starts a small business as a landscape gardener. Sounds innocent enough and quite lucrative, right? He targets elderly people. That's his demographic, specifically elderly people who live alone. It's creepy. In 1991, he does gardening work for two sisters in their 80s who live together, Alice and Helena. After he's finished, they notice 45,000 euros have disappeared from their house. They alert the authorities, of course, and he's picked up and interrogated, and then they let him go. Nothing ever comes of it. Later, one of the sisters, Alice, suffocates in her sleep. Okay. Coincidence? Not a chance. In December of 1991, an elderly woman by the name of Marie Louise is found dead in her home. The medical examiner rules her cause of death to be natural. Come to find out, Yvan has done landscaping work for her on multiple occasions. The plot thickens. In 1993, Francois, a childhood friend and alleged accomplice to Yvan Keller, alerts the police to his activities. Once again, nothing is ever done. In 1994, between January and April, three people who were neighbors all died. Augusta, Ernestine, and Marie. Just so happens, Yvan has done work for all of them. Marie is found dead in her bed, on her back. Ernestine is found the same way, and so is Augusta. These victims' families notice things that make them suspicious, like in one instance, the debit card or credit card, and the house keys are missing. And then the card is later used to try and make three withdrawals. Another case, the bedding is perfectly made on the bed, which we find out is his MO, even though this victim is too weak to do that due to hip problems. In another one, things in the house have been moved randomly. This dude is an odd duck. Later in 1994, shortly after these three murders, Francois once again alerts the police about his suspicion of Yvan. They take his statement, and again, nothing ever happens. What in the heck, man? Come to find out, this guy is indeed an accomplice, Francois, and he recommends targets for Yvan. People he knows that have money and valuable possessions in their homes, also people who are elderly and who are particularly heavy sleepers. Now, how in the heck does he know that? I haven't a clue. Interestingly, though, he is only providing Yvan with these homes for him to rob, not to murder. It's when he follows up and learns of their deaths that Francois grows suspicious and alerts the authorities. The medical examiner who examines Augusta says she died from cardiac arrest, likely due to great fear. Man, that's sad. What a dirtbag. In February of 95, Madeline, age 79, is found dead in her home. Her daughter-in-law later says a little cousin is who found her dead in her bed. Cause of death? A heart attack. Murder count is now up to 5. One final time, Francois goes to the authorities and provides yet another statement. They do nothing. The story goes that he isn't the only one who reports Yvan, but nothing ever happens. This is likely because he is considered such an upstanding citizen and great small business owner. He hides his murderous craziness well, the dirtbag, just like BTK, who I covered in another video. Check it out. His brother eventually goes to the police, Pierre, in 2000. He shares that Yvan has told him about the things he's stolen. He also shares with the police who his brother's accomplices are. This is prompted after a series of 6 burglaries, boom, 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 in the local area. The police question Yvan and his two female accomplices. They have no evidence, so the investigation is, of course, closed on March 30th, 2001, and officially dismissed by a judge on April 25th, 2001. Fast forward a couple years, June of 03, His brother Pierre goes to the cops again. Sounds just like Francois. A preliminary investigation is opened, and it's this investigation that will eventually lead to the arrest of Yvan Keller. 3 years later, in September of 2006, on September 20, he is arrested and placed in custody. Finally, got you now, dirtbag, gas bag, dirtbag. 48 hours of lockup, and he just spills the beans. I hate beans, but he spills the beans. Confesses to the 5 murders they suspect him of. Doesn't want better. Confesses to another 18. It's 23. Then he confesses to another 7. Makes it 30. Another 10. Makes it 40. And then another 110. For a total of 150. Yikes. During this confession, investigators finally confirm his MO. So, his work as a landscaper allows him access to homes, right? That makes sense. He looks unsuspecting. He was reputable. He had assistance in finding elderly victims. He always suffocates them with a pillow or a cloth. He ends up saying that if he didn't have a pillow nearby, he would stuff a cloth in their mouth and plug their nose. Scumbag. After each murder, he spends a good amount of time making the bed with the victim in the bed to make it look like they died peacefully in their sleep of natural causes. Then he steals everything of value to fund his gambling addiction. There it is. Another thing he does to fund his gambling addiction is to, you know, prostitute his girlfriend. When asked about the murders, Yvan says he considers it putting his victims to sleep. Initially, he says he didn't plan on murdering anyone, but as the robbery victims realized items were gone and blame him, he decides the best way to cover his tracks is just take them out too. Just murder. I wouldn't consider stop robbing. I'll just take it a step further and, you know, whatever, dude. Nuts. At the last minute, he refuses to cooperate with the investigation. He retracts his confession, basically. This happens because the prosecutors refuse to meet his demands, which is to find a home and a job for his current female partner. Once they refuse, he retracts the statement and just says he changes his mind, says he wouldn't lead them to all the crimes. He didn't sign the confession, so I guess technically it doesn't count in France. Not so in America. We catch you saying it. You nail your butt to the wall, sucker. So shortly after, on September 22nd, 2006, he is placed in his cell, where he quickly commits suicide by hanging himself with his shoelaces. What a coward. A man who neighbors and colleagues say is very helpful, friendly, affectionate to animals, and everybody's gentleman, murders 150 elderly women. Who in their right mind wants that to be their legacy? A man whose last words were, "I just wanted to be loved." Yeah, whatever you say, weirdo. Well, that's all for this episode of Serial Killers. If you enjoyed this video, please take a quick second to subscribe to my channel, All Things True Crime, so you won't miss my next video. On the next episode of Serial Killers, I'm going to cover Pedro Rodriguez Filho, also known as Pedrino Matador, which roughly translates to Killer Petey, also known as Little Pedro Killer. He is a prolific Brazilian serial killer who targets and murders over 100 people between 1967 and 2003. At 13 years old, he experiences his first deep urge to murder and gives into it shortly thereafter. Yikes. Until next time, stay safe.